Last week was part one. We really kicked off the 21 days of prayer and fasting, which a lot of you are doing. Fasting like TV, fasting social media. A lot of you are fasting types of food. A lot of you are on the Daniel fast. So my wife and I were on the Daniel fast. There's a lot of different types. We talked about fasting last week. So if you want to learn a little bit more about fasting, how important it is to the Christian walk, a walk of victory, then check out last week's message. Today we're kind of kicking off this thought of detox, and so when you think of even detox, and I'm communicating even detox, the things that come to mind are more of like the chemical substance abuse and alcoholism, maybe that comes to your mind. But there is so much more that we can ingest, not just into our body, but things that we can ingest that can contaminate us. And they contaminate not just our body, but there are things that we can ingest that contaminates our soul and our spirit. There are things that contaminate that because we are created with three parts of us. Every person has three parts. We have a body. It's what you see. This is our body, and that's obvious to everybody. But you also have a soul. It's the mental part. It's your mind. It's your mental capacity. It's your feelings. That's another part of you. And then there's a spirit, your spirit man, that is the eternal part of you. Now, the what you ingest into your mind and your soul, into your body, affects your spirit, and vice versa. They affect each other. Now listen, this is so important. This is why we're doing this series. If you are going to accomplish your dream in 2017, if you're going to fulfill God's purpose for your life this year in 2017, what's going to sabotage it the most is the flesh. And the Bible groups up the body and the soul into this one category called the flesh. And so what is going to sabotage your dream? What is going to sabotage you from living 2017, fulfilling your purpose, fulfilling God's plan, victorious? I'll tell you what it is. It's the body. It's your soul. It's and a lot of us, if we were honest, that's what's calling the shots in our life. The spirit man, that spirit part of us, is not strong enough to lead, so our feelings push us around. Our feelings push us around. And or our bodies, the cravings of our flesh, will tell us what to do. And so we're beginning this series, and what we're going to do is look at every three aspects of your being, your spirit, soul, and body, and we're going to have a detox process, the body, soul, and the spirit. And in this series, I have some challenges for you. I do have some additions for you in your fast. So every series, every message, today I'm going to be talking about the spirit detox, and I have some things for your spirit that I'm going to ask you, challenge you to detox from. And as well as your soul and your body. Now, it's not food, so don't get all like, no, I can't do it anymore, Pastor. I can't do it anymore. I'm already. It's not going to be food, you guys. But all of us, myself included, we can allow things into our lives that pollute us, you guys. And we need to detox. And again, it's not just alcohol and chemical, which reminds me of a joke. I need to tell you guys a joke because today's message is not a lot of laugh in it. So I got to get you laughing a little bit. It's a little strong today. So there's this joke, this story of a man who was drunk driving. It was at night, and he gets pulled over by a police officer. Police officer comes up to the window, and man rolls it down. And he says, "Have you been drinking today, sir?" And he says, "No, just water, sir." And he says, "I can smell the wine in there." And he says, "Well, Jesus must have did it again, man. Don't try that. Don't try that." But he says, but the cop says, "Hey, You're gonna have to come out here. I'm gonna have to do a breathalyzer on you, sir." And he says, "Oh no, I can't do that." The cop says, "Why?" He goes, "Well, I'm an asthmatic. If you make me do that, I could die right here on the street." And he goes, "Well, then I'm gonna have to take you back with me, and you're gonna have to get in my car. We're gonna have to go back to the station, and I'm gonna do a blood test on you. We're gonna figure out if you're drinking or not." And he says, "You can't do that. I can't do that." He said, "Why?" He said, "Because I'm a hemophiliac. You take my blood, I'll bleed to death. You're going to kill me, officer." And he goes, well, fine. I need you to get out of the car. I need you to walk this line." He says, "I can't do that." He said, "Why can't you do that?" He says, "I'm drunk." Yeah. Yeah. So I need you to think more broadly than that. We're going to detox more than just the body. There are things that are ingesting us, that are contaminating us, that are affecting you from accomplishing the purpose God has for you. Even your own desires, what are sabotaging your own desires, and we know it, It's our flesh. It gets in the way. It's the feelings, the soul, the body. So I want to use as a theme verse for this series, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, starting at verse 14, all the way into chapter 7, verse 1. We're going to read that whole portion there. And Paul, the Apostle Paul, is writing this letter to Christians. This is to the church. This is to the church at Corinth, to church people. He says this in verse 14. He says, hey, be careful. Do not be yoked together. He used that word, yoked. And I want to pause right there because a lot of us can just read that and pass right over it and not really know what that means. Kind of sounds like a religious word or a Bible word, and we just kind of read right over it. But that word in the Greek, the derivative of it, it means it comes from the word to common fellowship. So to have a closeness, to have a fellowship, is that so? Obviously, you can't get away from all things toxic, and you can't get away from all things worldly, but you have to be careful with the level of closeness that you have to those things. That's what he's saying. And so Paul says, don't get too close to the world. And then he asks some questions. For what does righteousness and wickedness have in common? And obviously, there's no commonality there. Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? And that's just a name for a demon or the devil. What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of, and I love this, we are the temple of the living God. So let me just tell you, this right here, the church buildings aren't sanctuaries. This is not a sanctuary. You are the sanctuary. This is not a holy place. You're the holy place. Look, the only reason why this place is holy at all is because people full of God's Spirit, people carrying the kingdom of heaven, decided to come in here and exalt the name of Jesus. That's the only reason why there is any level of holiness in this place. I built most of these walls with my hand. You guys, it's not holy. It was never God's intention to indwell buildings. It was never God's idea to indwell buildings. He always wanted to indwell you. Because the next verse, as God said, and then he's going to quote from the Old Testament here, a promise God made. God wants to live with you and walk among you. God wants to dwell in you. You're his temple. And I will be their God, and they will be my people. And then God says, here's how you do it. You got to come out from them and be separate. In other words, God is saying, I really want to have this intensity. I want to intensify the presence, my presence in your life, in your home, in every part of you, but you can't have this if you're too close to that. I want it for you, but you can't have it if you're yoked with other things. So come out from those things. So there has to be this process where you're analyzing what's in there that shouldn't be in there. And that's the question of the series, the question of the day. What's in there that shouldn't be in there? It's not jeopardizing whether or not you go to heaven. It's just messing with the journey. Okay? Because like when you confess, you're going to heaven. When you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you did that in your heart with your mouth, believed in your heart, God raised him from the dead. The Bible says you're saved. But the level of closeness now in your journey with Christ is dependent upon this. How close you are to him or far away you are from him. How much of your dreams are going to be fulfilled and how you fulfill the purpose of God for your life depends on how close you're either yoked to him or to the world. Come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Watch this. Touch no unclean thing, and I'll receive you. I'll be a father to you, and you'll be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Now check out this next verse. It's the next chapter, but it's the same continuing thought. Verse 1 of chapter 7 says, since we have these promises, which promises? That if we separate ourselves, God will come closer into our lives. Since we have them, look at this. Let us purify ourselves. Notice that God doesn't do the purifying here. God did the purifying when he saved you. Your spirit man is clean. You are saved. You're saved. But he says, look, look, now that I've saved you and I've sanctified you and cleansed your spirit, man, what you need to do is purify the rest of you. We have, now there's this process of either how close we get to God or how close we get to the world. So there's this, well, what do we need to be purified from? Everything that contaminates. Everything that pollutes our bodies, our minds, our spirit, every toxin. And that's what we're going to do for the next 3 weeks. We're going to look at the toxins that contaminate body and spirit. And we're talking about spirit detox today. So that we can perfect holiness out of reverence for God. So you say, Jason, well, how do you know I need a spirit detox? I think I'm doing okay. Well, let me give you the symptoms. If you're a candidate for spirit detox today, I'll show you through the scriptures. Maybe it's you. There's in Psalms chapter 13, this is a psalm of David. Here's what David said when he got too far away from God. Here's the symptom if you need a spirit detox. He said, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts? Time out right there. How many of you are wrestling with, oh, I want to do that, but I keep on doing this. And I wish I would do that, but I keep thinking about this, that there's this wrestle inside going on. Then you're in need of a spirit detox today. How long does this wrestling match with my thoughts go on? How long, he says, will I have sorrow in my heart? If you're wrestling with a heart of sorrow, you're a candidate for a spirit detox today. How long will my enemy triumph over me? This is King David, the leader of God's people, the friend of God, who went through a wrestling match with the enemy's plan for his life. Well, what do you do with that? In Romans chapter 8, I love this. I love Romans chapter 8 so much, but you got to read Romans chapter 7 to fully understand Romans chapter 8. And you should read it sometime, but in Romans chapter 7, Paul is describing his own wrestling match. He says, I keep doing stuff I don't want to do. I keep doing that stuff that I hate and I don't want to do. Here's a guy planting churches, writing two-thirds of the New Testament, saying, there are times that I don't do the right thing. I do the wrong thing. And he beats himself up a little bit at the end of chapter 7. He says, oh, what a wretched man am I. Who can rescue me from this body of death? And then chapter 8 comes in as the prescription. And it's what I wanted to deliver to you guys today. The prescription for a spirit detox. Look at it here in Romans 8, chapter 5. It says, those who live according to the sinful nature, here's what the problem is. They're thinking about the wrong stuff. They have their minds set on what that nature desires. Which means, if we're going to have an effective detox process, then we need to have a new plan of what's coming in and what's coming out, guys. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of the sinful man is death. And a lot of us have already experienced that. We know that's true. But the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. That's what I want for you. I want you, and a lot of you know you want that. You want this for yourself. You want to lead. You come in here and you sense God's presence and there's power and there's worship. And you know you love God, but then you leave here and you get pushed around by your feelings. You get pushed around by circumstances. You get pushed around by life, and you're not leading from that place of spirit anymore. Come on, I want you to lead. I want you to experience life and peace in 2017. I want you to fulfill everything that God has for you, and this is how you do it. The spirit man has to rise up and start leading again inside of you. There's got to be a process where we look and see what's in there that shouldn't be in there. Let me get that out. And this time of the year is just, you know, an effective time a lot for us to kind of do that and look into those things. A lot of us are doing reflection. But he says that we have an obligation. Therefore, brothers, we have an obligation. For it, that is to say, you can say it, well, then we should do something about it. We have an obligation. Well, we should probably do something about this. Not to the sinful nature, to live according to it. For if you live according to sinful nature, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you detox your life, you find the areas of contamination one by one, and you remove those things, you get them out, put to death the misdeeds of the body, he says, you will live. So here's what I want to do. There are three things. If you need a spirit detox today, and every single one of us from time to time, we need this. There are three things that we need to get out of our life, and there are three things we need to put inside of our life today. And this is my challenge to you is we're doing 21 days of prayer and fasting, but in these areas, I'm just asking for 6 days to get these things out of your life. I want you to test it. See how good God is. Test these three things to remove from your life, and the three things I'm going to tell you to put in. I'm not saying even 21 days on these things. I'm not saying for the rest of your life. I'm just saying give me 6 days and see the difference that God can do. See the difference that God can make. A lot of you have forgotten how good you can feel spiritually. You've forgotten that because the other areas of your life are dominated. I'm telling you, it feels good. It feels good to be led by God and led by your Spirit. So you have to starve certain three things, and then you have to feed three other things. Let me give them to you. Here's number one, if you're taking notes today. Number one, I'm asking you to starve this area to get rid of doubt. Doubt. Some of you don't even realize how much doubt has gotten into your life. That how much doubt is affecting your life. You know what doubt is? Doubt is believing what the world thinks and not what God thinks. That's what doubt is. Doubt is the single greatest enemy of confidence. It limits your potential. It causes procrastination. It causes you to miss the best of what God has for you. Doubt, not in your notes. James 1 and 6 says, whoever doubts is like a wave in the sea that is driven and blown about by the wind. When you doubt, you're letting your circumstances control you. If we don't get this toxin out of our life, your circumstances this year will control your life. You're going to hit a roadblock. You're going to hit a storm. You're going to hit something against you. And then you will again be, oh man, here it is. Off the mark again. If you don't get this thing called doubt out of your life. Joshua 1 and 9 up here on the screen says, be bold and strong. This is God telling Joshua, be bold and strong. I'm telling you, this year, 2017, come on, church, be bold and strong. Banish fear and doubt. That has no business in your land, has no business in your life, has no business in your territory. Get rid of the fear and the doubt. For remember, the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Come on, get rid of the doubt. So here's how it plays out for me. I'm like, oh my goodness. You know, I look at news, and the news and the killings and the ISIS and the conflict and all these things, and I'm like, it gets me like, God, are you seeing this? God, are you like, what are you gonna do about it? Are you gonna step in here at any time, God? What are you gonna do? And we forget, man, I'm the head, not the tail. I'm more than a conqueror. My king, my God is king, who sits enthroned on the heavens and the earth. We forget that so quickly. We start to buy into the reality of the world instead of God's reality. And we begin to doubt. Well, what do, you guys? We got to get more in tune with God's reality. More in tune with God's reality and less in tune with the world's reality. That's what we need to do. So write it down this way. I will trust what God says. Not what the world says. We got to get in tune with this, with what God says, and get doubt out. Here's a great verse, Proverbs 3:5. A lot of you know this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not in your own understanding, your own reasoning. We're going to detox doubt, and I'm going to show you how in just a second. Here's the second thing. I'm convinced that if our spirits are going to come alive, we need to detox from this thing called negativity. This year, we need to cleanse ourselves from all that negative talk, the negative people that maybe are influencing your life and in your life, that maybe you're a little bit too yoked together with some toxin and less yoked and close to God. I mean, negativity, just, it's raining again. Oh my God, I know we need it, but hell, the rain, why is it raining so much? And it's so cold. And then just like a month ago, they were like, when's it going to be winter? It's so hot. It's so hot. Bakersfield sucks, you know? And it's this walking around. You ever watch Winnie the Pooh? You guys used to watch Winnie the Pooh? Yeah? Winnie the Pooh? Yeah, I know it's old. I know it's a cartoon, but I used to watch that. Love it. You'd have Eeyore. A lot of people like Eeyore. Not doing too well today. And it's just no matter what's going on, he's just always so down and depressed. And we need to get some Tigger attitude back inside of us, guys. You remember Tigger? Tigger, man. The wonderful thing about Tigger, because Tigger's a wonderful thing. Come on now. Come on. That's what I'm, I mean, his top is made out of what? Rubber. His bottoms are made out of spring. There you go, church. Come on. He's bouncy, trouncy, bouncy, bouncy. Fun, 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 fun. But the wonderful thing about Tigger is, I'm the only one, right? I'm telling you, I thought it was silly, but you need to get some Tigger. Because it's funny, as Eeyore's all doo-doo-doo, down and depressed and stuff, and Piglet and Pooh are all like, oh, so nervous, and always all, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then Tigger jumps on his head, hey, hey. And they're like, hey, Tigger, you want to go ice skating? Fur. That's what Tiggers do best. Hey, Tigger, you want to go pick some apples? Fur. That's what Tiggers do best. I'm telling you, we need to get some more Tigger inside of us and less of that other negativity. Negativity, it can pollute your spirit. And sometimes I can even get like this, where I just think like, oh my goodness, that needs to change right away. And it just kind of, it affects me and I can get negative. Here's what we need to do. Two things. I want you to write two things down for this point. One, I will think what God thinks. Hey, if we want to get negativity out, we need to think what God thinks. We got to get that toxin out of our mind. Because in Isaiah 26, verse 3, it says, you will keep, God will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Well, I got to get my thinking right. And I'm going to give you another feeling for this one. And that is, right underneath it, write this down. I not only have to think what God thinks, but I have to say what God says. Okay, you got to do both. If you want to get negativity out of your life, not only you have to control your mind, you got to control your tongue. Some of you know I'm talking to you right now. Come on. We got to watch this. And this one is going to get all up in our business today. This verse right here. Here it is, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let that person who cut you off on the 99, go ahead, take that spot. That's all right. Go ahead. I didn't need it. Let everything you say be good and helpful. Well, I can't do that, Pastor. Well, can you for 6 days? Can you? Can you try it for six days? I'm not, and I want to challenge you. I don't always get this right all the time, Jason. But can you focus on it for 6 days? So why? So that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. There is life and death in the power of your words, you guys. Have you ever been around someone who's just like, after being around them, you just felt so much better, encouraged? You got to get this toxin out of your life. And it might be even some negative people. I don't know if it's the news for you or what it is for you, but you know what it is for you. So here's the next one. Here's the next one. The third one is obvious, and that is just sin. Sin. We need to detox from anything sinful that pollutes our spirit, man. Well, none of us gets this sin thing right all the time, but I wanted to give you kind of a cool thought about this, and that is most people, they see this word sin, and it immediately puts guilt inside you, like, ooh, like I feel condemned. I feel like that's a word that's just kind of pointing at me, condemning me, but that's not how God sees that word at all. In fact, the word sin just means miss the mark. Huperteia is what it is. That's what it is in the Greek. It just means to miss the mark. So follow me on this. Follow me. So when we, I believe that the reason why that we are missing the mark, and a lot of us can look back at 2016 and go, man, there are some areas that I kind of missed it. Now the areas that we are missing the mark in our life, I don't think it's much that we are a bad marksman. I don't think your aim is bad. I don't think that's the problem here. I think the problem is you're aiming at the wrong target. I mean, for many of us, if we're honest, that's the reason why the things that we wanted to do, we didn't end up doing them last year, is because, you know what, I wanted it. Like, there was a part of me that wanted it. Like, my spirit inside of me wanted that, but something else kept getting in the way. Man, I was sabotaged. It was sabotage. If I was honest, I really wasn't aiming for what I said I wanted, for what my spirit wanted. I started chasing other things. And so what I'm saying today is, that in this new year, that what we need to do is just re-aim. That's what we need to do. Just re-aim to the right target. Put our eyes on the on the right things. I was aiming at the wrong thing. So really the secret to overcoming sin isn't to get all condemned about being sinful. It's just I need to re-aim. I got a little bit off target. Now I need to re-aim. And that's why, by the way, the right response to sin is this word called repent. And again, that's another word that people go, ooh, that feels like it's condemning me. Repent. That's a religious word. No, that's not what, that isn't a condemning word. Repent just literally means to turn around. It means, hey, choose a new target. Change your direction. Like you're aiming at the wrong stuff, just turn around. Change your target. Change your direction. How many of us, as we've begun the new year, would agree that there were some areas in 2016 that we kind of just missed the mark? I mean, every one of us have areas. Can it be that we were just aiming at the wrong thing all along? We need to get this thing called sin out of our life. And that's why, write it down. We're going to detox. If we're going to detox this sin, write it down this way. I will turn to what God wants. Now, I don't know what that is for you, but you know. You know what that area of sin that's kind of a struggle for you. Like, you already know. I'm talking about it. And you already know exactly what that area is for you. I've been aimed at this. I need to re-aim over here. I need to adjust my target to a new direction. Look at what Romans chapter 6 says. He says, do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, and I love this, he says, give yourselves completely to God. Like all of you, every part of who you are, your body, your soul, your spirit, give yourself completely to God. So it's not just enough to detox, you guys. It's not enough just to get stuff out. I've been researching detox a lot. It's not just about getting the bad stuff out. You have to also get the right stuff in, some healthy stuff, some nutrients. You got to put the right things back into your life. So I have three of them for you. And I'm just asking for 6 days on this, you guys. I'm asking you to put God's word to the test. That for 6 days, no doubt, I'm not going to believe what the world says about life or about me. I'm going to believe what God says. Even as ridiculous as it may seem, as real as the world seems, I am not going to doubt God. And I'm not letting anything come in my mind that is negative. I'm not going to think it. I'm not going to speak it. And I'm going to adjust my aim. I'm just going to adjust. I got off a little bit in 2016. I'm just going to adjust my target here. And then we need to put three things back in. We need to feed some things. Write these down. Number one, we need to feed on God's word. Feed on God's word. I'm going to feed myself it. Because if we're going to believe what God believes, if we're going to think like God thinks, if we're going to, you guys, there's no other place to get that than the word of God, than the Bible. And really what the Bible needs to do is reprogram, kind of, like our minds. It needs to reprogram our thoughts to God's reality. We're so programmed to the world's reality. What the Word of God does is it reprograms us to God's reality, because we serve a nothing's too difficult, nothing is impossible kind of God. And if you don't believe it, just try it for 6 days. 6 days. Try it. Where you didn't allow these toxins, not the news, the game, the negativity, the certain people, I don't know, in your mind, and you just fed yourself God's word. Here's what's going to happen. Psalm chapter 1. Happy are those who reject the advice of evil men, who kind of just reject the toxic. Instead, they find their joy in obeying the law of the Lord, and they study it day and night. So here, I'm not asking you for 21 days on this even. Some of you are kind of newer to this thing. 6 days, just 6 days. Maybe it's a whatever it is, maybe it's not the news for you, like you're going to fast the news or anything, but I'm going to do that for 6 days. That's going to be mine, but it doesn't have to be yours. I'm encouraging you to shut out the voices of doubt, of worldly doubt, of worldly reasoning, and get into God's word. So the next blank there is blank. It's for you to fill in. So I want you to jot it down. Here's what I'm going to do. Maybe you're going to read a psalm a day, a proverb a day. You're going to get on a reading plan. What we like around here at Discovery is the one-year Bible reading plan. You can download it on your Bible app. It gives you a little Old Testament, New Testament, Psalm, and Proverb. It's about 15 minutes of reading a day, and you can read through the whole Bible in 1 year. But I'm going to get into God's Word, and I'm not asking again for the rest of your life, okay? I'm just asking for 6 days. Develop a new habit. Try it. and detox yourself. Here's the second prescription, and that is, I'm not only going to feed myself God's word, but I'm going to feed myself worship. Worship. And specifically, I'm talking about worship music here. And some of you may think I'm strange on this, and I get that. I understand. I am a little bit, I guess. So it's okay. But years ago, I decided that I was not going to let anything that did not glorify God enter my ears in the form of music. Years ago, I decided that. And I don't buy into the world's philosophy. I don't buy into the philosophy of the world at all. Which, by the way, the world's philosophy is primarily influenced through music. And so I said, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to cleanse myself of that. It was shortly after I dedicated my life to God, rededicated, like at 20 years old. And it was a couple months, maybe weeks after I got saved. And God did immediate work in some areas. In some areas, just like you, is just things kind of God working on me and showing me areas of my life. Well, I got my car one day, turned on, and the radio station I was listening to came on, and I heard it with my spirit, man. And I said, that's polluting me. I didn't even realize it until just, wow, like that is not okay for me to, and I made my mind up right there. I'm not going to allow the philosophy of the world to influence me. And it was. It was influenced my attitude, my actions. It was, and anything that you allow inside of you is going to influence who you are. Whether you think it or not, it is. So it may not have to be, I'm not putting that on you, but I am saying, if you spend 6 days, here's my challenge to you. You didn't allow any secular into your mind, specifically in the form of music, and instead you fill your mind with worship, you're probably going to feel a little detoxing, like withdrawals, like I need that. You're probably going to, but at around day 3-4, you're going to say, this is changing my life. This is changing my mind. This is changing me. What I'm letting in and what I'm putting my mind on is changing me. Here's the verse that describes it, Philippians chapter 4. It says, fix your thoughts on what? On whatever's true, honorable, and right, and pure, and lovely, and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. And I'm promising you, look at this, then the God of peace will be with you. Like you're going to experience a peace that no pill can give you, that no relationship can give you. I'm telling you, God's offering a closeness to those who will touch no unclean thing. Is this too deep for you guys? You okay? You okay out there? Take a little breath. It's going to be all right. We're going to get through this, okay? This is for you. So what's the blank there? It's for you to fill in again. You don't have to do mine. You don't have to do mine, but I'm just challenging you to, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to reduce this type, and I'm going to increase my worship in my life. I encourage you, I challenge you to do that in your life. And I want you to see how close God comes to you. And of course, here's the last one, and that is prayer. Prayer. And we're obviously in the middle of this 21 days of prayer and fasting, and we're just seeking God's presence and face and will for 21 days. But I understand that a lot of you are new to this thing called prayer. So here's just a bite-sized challenge for 6 days to pray. Like pray, seek God every day. Come to the morning. We have Monday through Friday, 6 to 7 a.m. There's like 40 to 50 people this week, every morning here, 40 to 50 people seeking God's face with us. It was beautiful. It's been an amazing experience. So we start off with worship. We have a devotion, and then we just get into God's presence. It's prayer. I challenge you, pray. And God almost dares you to do this. Do you know that? He does. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, He almost dares you when He says, if my people, they're probably not going to do it. They're probably not going to. You're probably not going to, but if you would, oh my good, if you would, I would do something. I'd respond. And I read this last week, but I want to read it this week out of the Message. It's really beautiful, powerful. If my people, my God-defined people, respond by humbling themselves, praying, and seeking my presence. That's what we're doing, 21 days, seeking the presence of God. God, we want you to intensify your presence in our life. We want to get closer to you. We're seeking your presence. And not only that, but I need to turn our backs on the wicked, the wickedness of this world, the things we need to detox from. He says, if you do that, I'll be ready for you. I'll be ready. Check this out. I'll listen from heaven, forgive your sins, and restore your toxic life. I will bring health back to your life, back to your land, he says. I'll get you healthy again. And I know for me, I want that. I want to begin 2017 right, aligned, aiming at the right target. I want everything God has for me this year. I don't want to miss out on not one experience, not one revelation, not one opportunity, not one thing that God has for me. I don't want to miss it. So in order for that to happen, I need to get some things out of my life. I need to remove some of these toxins, and I need to put some of the right healthy nutrients back into my life. Come on, let's do that together. Can we bow together in prayer?